So as many of you know, Action Canada was created by a public-private partnership. And I'm going to start off by acknowledging and thanking our private sector partner and co-chair of our board of directors, David Eisenstadt, who is with us here tonight. David, just wave to everybody. Notre partenaire avec le gouvernement fédéral, c'est le département de patrimoine canadien, et je me réjouis de la présence parmi nous le directeur général de la participation des citoyennes, Monique Léger. Welcome to Monique, and thank you for coming. So, chaque année, Action Canada sélectionne un maximum de 20 Canadiennes et Canadiennes d'exception pour participer à notre programme de 11 mois. Having identified our future leaders for the country, we then challenge them to tell us what are the pressing issues facing Canada and how we should address these issues.
So, good morning everyone. Bonjour à tous. Mon nom est Annie Sabourin. Je suis très heureuse de vous accueillir ce matin pour cette présentation intitulée Conjuguer l'éducation au futur, adapter les systèmes éducatifs canadiens pour le 21e siècle. My name is Annie Sabourin, and I'm very happy to welcome you all this morning, especially in these conditions, for this presentation entitled Future Tense, Adapting Canadian Systems for the 21st Century. We have identified the crux of this issue as the fact that the pace of change in the 21st century is simply unprecedented. Here we go. And this requires us to prepare for a future that we may not be able to imagine. This is both exciting and scary. We can't say precisely what the future will look like, but we know this. The world is getting smaller, and it's changing faster, and this trend is not going to slow down. Emerging industries will lead the way to new technologies and innovations. Globalization means that we're more connected than ever with the rest of the world, their struggles, and diversity. So the average person in this room has been away from high school for quite some years, let's say maybe 20, 25 years. I'm sure that on a Friday morning like today, you were not checking Facebook between classes. Students today, like my daughter, who's in fourth grade, will need to be educated about making the best use of these new tools. So as education systems are the primary source of learning in our society, this is where we should focus our attention and integrate a new learning paradigm for the 21st century.
What we're thinking about here is no longer just teaching information, but now thinking about what the skills are that the students are going to need in order to be competitive and be able to be successful in the future. So, the first competency that we've identified is creativity, innovation, and entrepreneurship. La créativité, entrepreneuriat et l'innovation. So what is this? This is about teaching our students to be able to use failure as an opportunity to learn, to be able to take risks, because without doing that, we're actually failing our students for when they go out into the world. The second is critical thinking. And this is not actually a new skill that we're talking about. It's something that's been around from the time of Socrates. So it's something that has been in the educational discourse for a long time. But what we mean now is, in this globalized world that we're living in, how are students able to take the information that they get from sources that are very different from the environments that they grow up in and absorb that, question it, and form their own conclusions in a very fast-paced world? The next is computer and digital literacy. So again, we're talking about not technology as the only source of change in this world, but one of the key components of it. And so computer and digital literacy means that students need to be able to communicate effectively with digital media and to be able to articulate themselves through those and use them appropriately. So things like bullying and being citizens both in the real world as well as in the digital world become important.
So change in education systems begins at the policy level. So we started by looking at provincial policy. To examine the intentions of each province in regards to 21st century learning, we reviewed provincial education documents. We selected to focus on five Canadian provinces: New Brunswick, Quebec, Ontario, Alberta, and British Columbia. Combined, these provinces represent the incredible diversity of Canada, and as well as nearly 90% of our population. Current and relevant education documents were identified in each of the selected provinces and analyzed for the presence of the competencies, as well as the structure and language of how they were described. Following this analysis, it's clear that almost all the provinces we examined agree about the importance of changing their education systems to better prepare students for the future. The clear challenge is that the language and priorities by which these competencies are discussed is highly varied across Canada and represents a significant opportunity for improvement. All the provinces are trying to introduce 21st century learning, but the discussion seems to be varied between the provinces. People are talking about it in different ways, and they're having little interprovincial discussion. This provincial policy analysis allowed us to have a snapshot of the current provincial intentions in regards to 21st century learning. To assess their state of implementation, we embarked on a national teacher survey to assess the presence of 21st century learning competencies in the classroom.
So we fielded the survey to teachers in each of the provinces where we did a policy examination. We had nearly 1,000 respondents, which is a fairly substantial sample, and it was well represented across most key demographic indicators, so we can draw some preliminary inferences. And it is actually the first systematic comparison of 21st century learning between provinces in Canada. The teachers indicated that the implementation and facilitation of 21st century learning in classrooms is very different from province to province. We not only see differences in emphasis and outcomes, we also note that there's no discernible consistency between the policy priorities in a given province. We take Ontario, for example. It places a great deal of emphasis on character development in its education strategy. But if you see here, we ask teachers what is their individual level of emphasis, what emphasis do they personally put on character development, and what emphasis do they think the curriculum places on teacher development, character development. It was asking teachers to give us a glimpse into what's going on in their classrooms. If we really want to understand 21st century learning, teachers are the front line. They are the facilitators of learning. They are the ones who see this every day. They are best positioned to tell us what's going on inside the classroom. So it's interesting that although Ontario, in its policy documents, places more emphasis on character development than any other province that we studied, teachers say that although they find it to be very important, the curricular emphasis on character development is lower than any other province that we included. So it suggests that there's a mismatch between where policies on education are putting their priorities and where teachers think the priorities in the curriculum end up manifesting in the classroom. Teacher education and professional development. This was the most striking result in the survey. And what in the survey findings, teachers who recently engaged in professional development activities in any of the competencies related to 21st century learning, not just those that we studied in our survey, were more likely to report higher levels of 21st century learning in their classrooms. So teacher education and professional development is in fact one of the key criteria for ensuring the facilitation of 21st century learning. Teachers are the source that we need to focus on. They are the focal point. Now, more research into these findings is required, and indeed it's encouraged. But they do provide us with a number of important insights into how 21st century learning is manifesting in Canadian classrooms, and they offer us some prospective pathways towards improvement.
So based on these findings, we offer the following recommendations. Nous proposons donc la création d'un secrétariat de l'apprentissage au 21e siècle au sein du Conseil des ministres de l'Éducation. By establishing a 21st century learning secretariat within the Council of Ministers of Education, the coordination problem would be dealt with. Now, why CMEC, the Council of Ministers of Education? Well, because for the last 45 years, it has been an important national organization that now represents all 13 jurisdictions and is resourced with competent staff. CMEC's own mission statement is to act as a forum to discuss policy issues and to act as a mechanism through which to undertake activities, projects, and initiatives in areas of mutual interest. Notre deuxième recommandation et de prioriser la formation des enseignants afin qu'ils soient bien au fait de l'apprentissage au 21e siècle. Comme nous l'avons vu et entendu déjà, il y a une relation directe entre la formation des enseignants et leur capacité à enseigner en intégrant les compétences du 21e siècle. C'est donc une approche en deux temps. Premièrement, le cursus de formation des futurs enseignants devrait intégrer des modules spécifiques sur l'apprentissage au 21e siècle. Pour ce faire, une revue des programmes de formation des enseignants doit être faite afin d'évaluer les forces et les lacunes de chacun des programmes et de s'assurer que les enseignants reçoivent une formation les préparant à enseigner pour le 21e siècle. Secondly, we should not forget the tens of thousands of teachers that are currently teaching in classrooms. The access to continuing education opportunities, particularly in the area of 21st century learning, should be offered and strongly encouraged. But also a bottom-up approach in the form of an online 21st century learning portal for teachers where they could exchange sample lesson plan or best practices or discussion groups could be a cost-effective way to share knowledge. So the implementation of these two recommendations would go a long way into addressing the issue that we're talking about here.
Now, it's easy to equate 21st century learning directly with technology. In fact, we've heard a great deal about technology throughout our presentation already. But critically, more than anything, in fact, our work shines a spotlight on the importance of bringing to bear all of our human assets to meet the challenges of the day. If we're to be successful in realizing a 21st century education system, the leaders of today, those in power today, will need to practice the very same skills. We know that in a society that is deeply political and fractured by constant trade-offs between various priorities, we'll actually need to invest some of our hard-earned political capital towards making these ideas a reality. Dans ce contexte, il est parfaitement clair que la conversation ne s'arrête pas ici. C'est pourquoi, la semaine prochaine, notre équipe a été invitée à faire une présentation dans le cadre d'une conférence sur l'éducation à côté des décideurs les plus influents au Canada. So in view of the recommendations that we've made today, I'd like to first thank you for your dutiful attention and certainly invite questions and comments so that we can dive into, you know, the meat of what we've been presenting at this point.
My name is Bob McGahey. I'm with the Canadian Teachers Federation. Full disclosure, so. First, I'd like to thank the panel for their discussion and their ideas this morning, and it's certainly work that we've been doing at the Federation. The question I have for you is why this perception, and I'll think back to when I was in school. When I was in school, we took a history textbook, and we looked at it, and my teacher told me, don't believe everything you read here. Think about it critically, because the author has misconceptions. So that was part of our education system, and I would argue, has always been part of our education system.
What we're actually saying here is, let's take the best practices from these teachers who are doing things really well, who are facilitating some of these core competencies that we call 21st century learning, and we're doing it in the 20th century. And let's ensure that there's information sharing and knowledge sharing to make sure that these practices become national practices.
If people K-12 spent 30% of their time failing, and they understood that they can't get an A in their course unless they're failing, right? I mean, it's night and day from the way we teach today, but like, how do you get provincial governments to start thinking about stuff like that?
All parents want their kids to succeed and perform. If you take the time to teach the parents and explain that it will become acceptable and to fail, and it will become a learning experience, then I think you can see that change coming.
And if we can share these ideas and really have them made more aware and have these practices shared through something like the online portal that we proposed, we might be able to get more standardization in terms of sharing and having more people have access to these resources as well.